dear finalists and winners of the Apps for Digital Peace competition, dear participants, honorable judges, it's an honor and privilege for me to address you today. I'm sorry that I can't do it in person. I'm sorry that I can't do it live. But that's the result of the COVID pandemic. So today is Sunday. I'm pre-recording my remarks from the Tallinn Airport. I'm on my way to Brussels to attend at the European Parliament meeting. And tomorrow, when you will be listening to my pre-recorded text, I will be voting on some of the important bills that are connected to fight against COVID-19 pandemic. That's the reality. We're in the middle of the COVID-19 crisis. Pandemic has already changed our world. It has put digitalization and cybersecurity high on political agenda. It has already shown that digitalization and access to internet are crucial for e-schooling, remote working, also for running democracy. Apps for Peace competition could not have been more timely, and I am incredibly happy and thrilled to talk to you today. I would like to start with my personal story. My name is Marina. I'm almost 60. I'm a woman. I'm a grandmother. I'm a lawyer. I'm a politician. I studied law. I represented Estonia in more than six countries. I was Estonian foreign minister, and at some point I was stuck with cybersecurity. I do not have any IT education, and I do not know how to program. So how did it happen? I'm Estonian. I come from a country which is unique. Yes, Estonia is a country. We call it e-lifestyle, and we are proud of the thousands of online services that we are providing to our citizens and to our residents, and also our digital residents who live abroad and want to have advantage of what we are offering them. There are only three things that you can't do in Estonia today online: to get married, divorce, and buy property. All the other things can be done without leaving your house. We have enjoyed this lifestyle for now more than 30 years, and we know that all the benefits of e-lifestyle come with challenges and vulnerabilities. Estonia was the first country in the world to fall under cyber attacks from another country for political reasons. It was in 2007 when DDoS attacks were targeting my country. They were primitive to today's standards, but they were something new and unique in the world. I was then Estonian ambassador to Russia, and in a quick time, I had to learn about DDoS attacks. I had to start working with Russian officials to find those who were behind those attacks. Why with Russian officials? Because the attacks were coming from the territory of that country. I tried, but we couldn't cooperate because there wasn't will on that side of the table. But what we learned that cooperation is crucial for cyber stability. Operation is crucial for free, open, stable, safe, and secure internet. We also learned that the challenges we meet either in Europe, in Asia, in Africa, in the United States, are the same. Today I'm wearing my cyber bugs. One of those bugs was presented to me by my IT department from the Estonian Ministry of Foreign Affairs when I stepped down as Estonian Foreign Minister, and the guys told me that they hoped that that's the only bug in my life. Another bug was presented to me when I stepped down as the chair of the Global Commission on Stability of Cyberspace, Global Commission. They're similar, which shows once again that the challenges we're facing today are very similar, and we can only overcome them and tackle them when working together. Charles Percy Snow, Baron Snow, was an English novelist and physical chemist who also served in several important positions in the British civil service. He is known for the Two Cultures, a lecture in which he laments the gulf between scientists and literary intellectuals. It was in 1959 when he argued that the intellectual life of the whole of Western society was divided into two separate parts, the sciences and the humanities, and that the two kinds of academic pursuit were separated by an ever-deepening gulf of incomprehension, dislike, and mistrust. The core of his argument was that the application of science and technology and the prosperity that was presumed to follow offered the best hope for meeting mankind's fundamental needs, but that this goal was being frustrated by the gulf of ignorance between the two cultures. By the way, if you hear other sounds, I remind we are in the airport, but we can pre-record it because of the advancement of the use of ICTs. But ignorance, does it sound familiar in 2020, more than 60 years later? I would argue that for years, online world was divided between, on one hand, IT people who thought that World Wide Web belonged exclusively to them and spoke the language that we ordinary people could not understand. And on the other hand, were ordinary people who didn't understand what IT people were talking about. Some years ago at the Black Hat USA, I had the privilege to listen to a keynote address delivered by the then Facebook Chief Information Security Officer, Alex Thomas, who talked about diversity and need of investing into young talents. He spoke the language that I understood, and I'm very impressed that Alex did not only say these things, but also has acted according to his words. He's a professor at Stanford University today, and he's also judge of this competition. Yes, education is crucial. There was a World Economic Forum study that said that for children entering preschool today, 65% of the job types that will exist when they graduate from college don't exist today. What that means is that we aren't preparing our kids for specific jobs. Rather, what we have to do is develop a set of skills they can take and map into jobs, job types that don't even know what they are right now. And you are those kids. You are the ones who have this set of skills. Education is crucial. I can say it from the experience of Estonia. In the 90s, last century, we started Tiger's Leap, an educational program for secondary schools. And when those guys graduated, they invented Skype. Yes, Skype, TransferWise, were invented by Estonians, and those young guys are the real role models for today's youth. The debate on international peace and security issues in cyberspace is at a critical juncture today. We are deliberating on the path that will probably decide the next decade of international cybersecurity, and therefore also play a role of how we experience cyberspace's most important infrastructure, the internet. Cyber attacks have become a new normality. They have become more sophisticated. They cause huge economic loss. They even threaten democracy. In today's polarized world, it has become more important than ever before to adhere to international law and norms of responsible state behavior. It is important to call out those who violate international law, and it is crucial to cooperate with all stakeholders. Dear participants, it is good to know that you have given much thought to the existing challenges and you have concrete suggestions that can turn the world into a cyber safer place. I would like to say some words particularly to girls and women participating in this competition. First of all, I would like to recognize you and I would like to compliment you for being part of the competition. I strongly support the thought that there is not enough women in cyberspace, in cyber stability, in programming yet. Present situation reminds me how much time it took and how difficult it was for women to enter diplomacy, foreign policy, security policy. Finally, women have occupied some very important posts in governments, international organizations, even some IT companies. But a lot has to be done. There is a long way to go. When talking about women in cybersecurity, we remember English mathematician Ada Lovelace, the daughter of poet Lord Byron. She's been called the first computer programmer for writing an algorithm for a computing machine in the mid-1880s. In 1980, the US Department of Defense named a newly developed computer language ADA after Lovelace. Today I had the chance to hear from Her Excellency Izumi Nakamitsu, United Nations Undersecretary General of Disarmament Affairs, a Japanese woman who fought stereotypes and broke a glass ceiling in order to become one of the world's top diplomats in the field of security and cybersecurity. I have the honor of knowing Izumi personally, and I admire it very much. This weekend, world mourned and remembered notorious RBG. Yes, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, late Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States. Look how many people from different countries, different backgrounds, are writing and talking about her. She was one of those brave women who also broke stereotypes and glass ceilings. She will be always remembered for her professional work, her personality, and also her wise words. I remember reading about her mother. She said, and I quote, "My mother told me two things constantly. One was to be a lady, and the other was to be independent. The study of law was unusual for women of my generation. For most girls growing up in the 40s, the most important degree was not your BA, but your MRS." Different centuries, different stories, different women. What unites them is the fact of being role models for others. And today, ladies, you are the role models for my generation and for generations to come. Dear participants and finalists, today you all are winners. Your participation in this competition has shown the whole world that young people care and are ready to take responsibility. This competition was launched in January to stimulate original thinking on ways to promote an open, secure, stable, and accessible cyberspace for all, but also to find new Windsurfs or Bob Kahns, but also Ada Lovelaces. I would like to thank you, to congratulate you, and wish you all success in future endeavors. We are looking at you with admiration, hope, and certainty. And to conclude, please allow me to tell another personal story. I'm a grandmother of three wonderful, extraordinary, nice boys. And I was this weekend babysitting two of them. One was 2 years old, another is 2 months old. One of them learned to brush his teeth watching a video from iPad. And he was now brushing his teeth very professionally. I watched him and I wondered. My grandmother never saw TV. I was born when there was no internet. My grandson is learning to brush his teeth watching a video from iPad. What will his grandson be able to do? I don't know the answer, but there is a lot to think about. Thank you for attention, and I wish you all success.